الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي أضعف ما حمده جميع خلقه كما يحبه ويرضاه سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعلنا دعاة إليك وإلى رسولك أما بعد فقد قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مثل المؤمنين في تواضعهم وتراحمهم وتعاطفهم كمثل الجسد الواحد إلى الآخر الحديث صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق رسول الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين ومن الشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين Indeed, all praises are for Allah, and we praise Allah, and we glorify Allah, and we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us with this gift of life. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us the gift of Iman, the gift of being given the title of being called a Muslim, the gift of Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We thank Allah for this deen al-Islam. We thank Allah for the Quran. فَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ If only you would try to count the blessings, the mercies, and the favors that Allah has bestowed upon you, Allah says, لَا تُحْسُوهَا You'll never be able to count them. They are so enormous. They are so much that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He continues to give us every single day, the breath of life, the beat of the heart, the vision of the eyes, the hearing of the ears. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the speech in the tongue. So many different ni'mat and bounties that we wouldn't ever be able to count them all. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we testify that he is the seal of the prophets. He is the last of the prophets. No other prophets would come be after him. 124,000 prophets came. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, being the last and the final of them all. My dear brothers and my dear sisters, Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed for us, when we look at the ummah, we will see that this gift of Islam, it has brought the ummah together. This gift of Islam, it has built bond and it has broken barriers. When we go way back in the times of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we would see a lot of different sects and tribes. Many different tribes, the Quraysh, Banu Asad, Banu Tamim, so many different tribes, and each tribe had a different leader. When Islam came and it governed in the land of Arabia, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in their midst. When he was chosen as a Nabi, people were still of different beliefs. People were still worshipping idols, Lat, Manat, Uzza. People were still taking stones, dates, trees, all different things they were taking as their Ilah and their God. When Islam came, it became universal throughout the world that the Muslims were united upon one thing, and one thing, and they will continue to be united upon that thing. And the first and foremost thing that brought the hearts of the Muslims together as a united body, as a united nation, is the fact that we all believe in La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. That there is none except Allah. Allah is a name that has been given to our Creator. It is such a name that when we study the Arabic language, we will understand that Allah doesn't only mean God. Allah does not only mean a God. Because for the word God, you can add an S to the end and you will get gods. Or you can add some other letters and you will get goddess or goddesses. But Allah, the word Al in Arabic, Alif Lam, it means D. It makes something definite. If I say Kitabun, it means a book. It can mean any kind of book. Kitabun. If I put Alif Lam in front of that, it becomes Al-Kitab. It becomes the book. It's a specific book now we are speaking about. When we say Ilah in Arabic, Ilah, it means a god. Ilah. When we put Alif Lam in front of that, we get Allah. Now we are speaking about what? The God. Who is the God of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the God of the entire creation? He is called Allah. He is the God, the one and only. And Muslims are united upon this, that the name of our God and our Creator is Allah, and He has 99 attributes. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Qudus, Al-Jabbar, Al-Mukmin, Al-Muaynin, Al-Aziz, Al-Jabbar, Al-Sami, Al-Basir. 99 names Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. And this is one of the factors of unity for this ummah. This ummah is also united upon the fact that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Khatimun Nabiyin. He is the seal of the prophets. Anybody believe that there is a prophet after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is not of the Islamic belief. He is out of the pale of Islam. So this is one of the other factors that the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is united upon, that we believe in our Lord, who is called Allah, the God of the believers, and we believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the seal of the messengers. Muslims also, we believe that there is one book of guidance for the believers. It is known as Al-Quran. Al-Quran. Allah says that we have revealed it on a special night. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. The month of Ramadan, the month in which was revealed the Quran, in a period of 23 years, Allah sent revelations to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our guide, our code, this book that we follow, it's universal. We believe in that. We are united by that book, which is known as the Quran. The Muslims are also united by one Qibla, one direction. We don't turn to any direction that we want to pray. When it is time to pray, we face one direction and one direction alone, the direction of the Holy Kaaba. It was in the times of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even when he was living in the land of Makkah, even when he was given the title of a Nabi, a prophet, they used to face Jerusalem to pray. They used to face Masjid al-Aqsa and pray. So we were not united as an ummah, because the Jews also faced there. The Christians at Najran in those times, they also faced that Qibla, that direction. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw the restlessness of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Quran for itself, it mentions, قَدْ نَرَاكَ تَقَلُّبَ قَدْ نَرَا تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. We were looking at you, we were seeing you when you were turning your face towards the heavens in grief, in worry, in anxiety. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was looking at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His heart was to turn towards the Qibla, the direction of the Holy Kaaba. His heart's desire was that. Allah said, we were observing you, we were watching you. فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاكَ. So now, we have appointed for you, we have assigned for you a Qibla that will make you very happy. You will become pleased with that. فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. Now, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, turn your face towards Masjid al-Haram, towards the Kaaba. وَأَيْنَ مَا كُنْتُمْ. And anywhere you people, believers, wherever you might be, فَوَلُّ وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَ. turn your faces towards that direction. So Muslims are united upon the fact that we have one Qibla, we have one direction. No matter where we live, China, Tobago, New York, Canada, wherever we might be, one direction and one direction alone, we face towards the Holy Kaaba. The Muslims are also united upon the fact that five times every single day, the Muslims are united in Salah. The Muslims are united five times every day in Salah. Or is it really so? Is Salah a form of unity? Or is Salah a form of disunity amongst the Ummah today? In those days, in the times of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what we are speaking about is some factors that the Ummah is supposed to be united upon. In those days, in the times of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as long as the adhan was sounded, the Muslims will hasten towards performing their salah in the masjid. In our times, we could hear it, we don't want to hear it, it doesn't really make a difference, except for some of us. Today, the norm of the Ummah is where you put your hand. If you put it on your chest, if you put it below the navel, if you put it on the side, however you put it, that is an issue for this Ummah. Not whether or not a person performs Salah, you know. We are not united in Salah anymore because big, big issues, but you didn't pray correctly. Look how you open your foot wide. Look how you're closing your foot so small. Look how you're saying Ameen aloud. Look how you didn't say Ameen. And we condemn each other, even though we would have just stood and performed Salah. Whether it be in a different manner, whether it be in a different way, we are all performing Salah, praying to one Allah, turning one direction with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as our leader, final messenger, but still we have performed that Salah and we tell each other, but you didn't pray correct. Who are we to judge each other? Who are we to say whether I put my hand on my chest or I put my hand here or I put my hand below my navel or I put my hand on the side, I am praying wrong or I am praying right? That is for Allah to decide. That is for Allah to decide. But Salah, it is what supposed to be, or it is supposed to be a factor of unity for this Ummah, because it is one of the greatest gifts that Allah has given to this Ummah. One of the greatest gifts. Another thing that the Muslims are supposed to be united upon is Sawm, fasting. That in the month of Ramadan, only in the month of Ramadan, the Muslim believes that fasting is made fard and compulsory for him. We can fast throughout the year, but only in Ramadan it is compulsory. Only in Ramadan. Muslims are also united on the fact that the pilgrimage, the Hajj pilgrimage, it comes once a year and it's on specified days. We have no differences of opinions when it comes to that. Just yesterday we would have seen a very beautiful form of unity when we would have gathered at the abattoir to kill our animals. So many people were gathered there. Everybody united on helping this one, helping that one, cutting up the meat, killing the animals. Everybody was in a form of unity. Why can't we live like this throughout the year? Why can't we be like this throughout the year? Is unity, is it for one day or one month? Or is it a seasonal thing? Occasionally. This is what the Ummah has come down to. That we only unite on certain aspects of the deen. When Islam came to remove every single form of disunity, when these people in the times of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were disunited, Allah says, وَاتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Allah sent the Quran and he commanded you, hold on to this book all together. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And do not be disunited in regards to this book. Today, this very book that came to unite the hearts of the Muslim, this very book, subhanallah, we are disunited upon this book. The Quran, we debate about it, we contradict one another. The Quran, Allah is saying, وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. It is a command from Allah. Do not differ amongst yourselves in regard to this book. Do not become enemies. Why? Allah is saying, وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. Remember the favors of Allah upon you. إذا كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم. When you were enemies to each other and we join your hearts together through this book known as the Quran. You were enemies. You were fighting each other. You were debating with each other. You were quarreling with each other. You were killing one another. And the Quran came and it stopped you from that. You were united upon that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and you were united upon him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ana Rabbul Kaaba, you became united upon that. All the factors of unity came and you became united upon that once upon a time. But where is the standing of the ummah today? Where is the standing of the ummah today in regards to unity? We had reached so far in the times of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those people, they had reached so far that the Quran says, وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَىٰ شَفَىٰ حُفْرَةٍ مِّنَ النَّارِ. You were on the brinks of falling into the fire of hell. That is how far these people were. They were on the brinks of falling into the fire of hell. فَأَنْقَذَكُمْ مِّنْهَا. But we saved you from that. We saved you from falling. We saved you from falling into that. When Allah brought all these factors of unity to us, Allah says, فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِقْوَانًا. With all these factors, we made you into one brotherhood. One brotherhood, one nation, one ummah. And we are called the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَكَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ آيَاتِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. Allah says like that, we reveal our signs, we show our signs to you, we relate our signs to you, these clear ayats, these clear evidences of Allah, we show them to you. Why? So that you will be guided upon this path of unity. That is what Allah is saying. Where is the standing of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Where is the standing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Muslims believe that every person from amongst humankind came from Adam and Eve. That is a fact. We believe that. Not like other people. They have differences of opinion. But we believe that as the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muslims believe that we have to die one day and we will go into this earth because we were created from earth. Minha khalaqnakum. From the earth we created you. Wa fiha nu'idukum. Into the earth we return you. Wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra. From the earth we will bring you back to life again. Muslims believe that after death there are two worlds, a world of bliss and a world of punishment. It's either heaven or hell. It's not in this land, like some people say, heaven and hell right here. Some people believe after you die, you will come back as this, you will come back as a butterfly, a dog, a cat, whatever, how you live in this world. Muslims don't believe that. We are united upon the fact that we believe when we die, we have to stand before Allah. We have to give an account to Allah. It's either Jannat or it's either Jahannam. We believe that. Or at least we were supposed to believe that. But my dear brothers and my dear sisters, all these factors of unity, when we count them in our hands, and there are many more, we see the simple things we become disunited for. We begin to quarrel. Look at the disbelievers, look at their ways. And we will see from that time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam until now, they have one purpose alone, to destroy the ummah, to destroy this deen of Allah, to destroy the book of Allah, to wipe out the Islamic beliefs of the Muslims. Look and you will see, they started at that time to destroy Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How many times they tried? Because by killing him, it would have meant that what? The death of Islam. But subhanallah, Allah kept Islam flowing. Allah kept Islam flowing. They were never able to kill him. So his message started to flow throughout the world. Throughout the world, Allah tells us in the Quran about their plot and their plight. Look and you will see how they operate from that time until now. Allah says in his book, and Allah is no liar, he says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضُ. Those people who disbelieve in Allah, the disbelievers, some of them are protectors for some. Some of them are helpers for some. They are united on their friendship. He says, O Muslims, illa taf'aluhu takun fitnatun fil ardi wa fasadun kabir. If you don't do like how they are doing in uniting yourselves together, then there will be tumult on the land. Wars will come upon the land. Battles will come upon the lands. Oppression on the land. And a great fitna, a great corruption. Look at the ummah today and see if these words of Allah are proven to be true. Throughout the Muslim world, whether it be Nigeria, whether it be Sudan, whether it be Somalia, whether it be Chad, whether it be Syria, whether it be Sham, Turkey, Istanbul, you name it. The Muslim world is in turmoil. The Muslim world is in corruption. The Muslim world is in oppression. Wars, battles, fights. So many different things. Why? The unity of the Ummah. We unite, you know what? Have a big party tonight, boy. You call up your friends. We unite upon that. Everybody calling one another. You have a big fete to go to. We unite upon that. We gang up. When we have a little crime to commit, we call our partners. We plan it properly. We unite upon that. We have a little robbery to put down. We plan it nice. Whatever the evils, we plan it. We are united upon that. When you have a lecture in a mosque, when you have Salah to go to, nobody here call and say, but I'm passing for you for Salah. We have a lecture coming up next week. We have a barbecue in the mosque. We're not uniting on them things at all. We're not uniting upon it at all. We're not coming together at all. But every other thing we will see. Look at the Islamic world and we will see what is happening to the Ummah of Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is telling us, if you people don't become like how the kuffar has become, united in their plot and their plan to destroy you, if you don't become united too, then this is exactly what is going to happen. What we are seeing happening on the face of the earth today. That is going to happen. Allah's words, it is the truth. We can't hide from it. We may try to run, but it will become apparent in front of our eyes. Read the history of Syria and you will see clubbing, partying, homosexuality. Read it and you will see prostitution in the land that was governed by Muslim Islamic rule. What has happened today? Bulldozer, bombs, wars, killing. You know what happened after all that? People started now to come back towards the Sharia. Look out. Dubai. We see Dubai, that Islamic state. Right now it's rampant with that. All these forms of oppression, all these forms of promiscuity is going on in Dubai right now. Until and unless the azab of Allah falls upon us, then we for ourselves, look at ourselves individually and we will see. It is only when Allah brings a punishment upon me, then I am ready now to come back to Allah. Now I am ready as an individual, far more for a country, a city, a nation. When Allah azab comes, then we are ready. Oh Allah, we are ready now. That is the time. That is what many people wait for, even in the times of the nations of the past. When Allah's azab comes, they say, no Allah, we are ready. Take back your azab. But it's too late. It's too late. The nation of Saleh, Hud, Yunus, Lut, you look at all the nations and you will see with your own eyes. Read your history and you will see. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not lie. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does his work. We have people, we live amongst people. We have to understand who we are, what we are, what do we represent, who do we stand for, and what do we stand for. Allah tells us that the believers, they are one brotherhood. One brotherhood. Innama al-mu'minun al-iqwa. They are one brotherhood. And Allah gives an example through His Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the example, مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي تَوَاضِهِمْ وَتَرَاحُمِهِمْ وَتَعَاطُفِهِمْ. The example of the ummah, the believers, subhanallah, in their love sharing, in their affection, in their compassion, in their mercy to one another, كَمَثَلِ الْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ. It's just like one body. Your body alone. Look at your body and see what happens to your body. Look at this example that this man, 1,437 years, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at this example he is putting forth us. He says the example of the believers in the way they show love for one another, compassion for one another, mercy to one another, affection to one another. It's just like one body. What happens? He says, إِذِشْتَكَ مِنْهُ عُذْوٌ تَدَاءَ لَهُ سَائِرَ الْجَسَدْ بِالسَّحَرِ وَالْحُمَّى. If one part of your body aches, the entire body, it rushes to heal that ache. It rushes to cure that pain that you are feeling. The eyes will start to shed tears. Waters will start to fall. Why? Because you get a cut under your foot. A brother got a cut in his finger just the other day. The eyes start to flow water. The fingers start to jump. The body is paining. Fever is coming. The whole body is running to assist. This is how the ummah has to be. When one person feels a pain, we have to run to assist. We have to go to help. You know what we say today? But we are not time for them, you know. We are not time for them. Yeah, this is how the ummah has become. We have separated ourselves from the world. It's all about, as I said yesterday, nafsi, 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 me, me, me. This is how the ummah has become. It cannot be like that, my dear brothers and my dear sisters. When we act like that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, we have to investigate ourselves and see how far we are from the munafiq, from the hypocrites. Because he says, Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرَكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. That the munafiq, the hypocrites, they will be in the lowest part of Jahannam, the deepest part of Jahannam. Subhanallah. The deepest part, that is where they will be. وَلَنْ تَجِدَ لَهُمْ نَصِيرًا. They won't find anybody to assist them. No help whatsoever for them. None. Then he says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَابُوا وَأَسْلَهُوا وَأْتَسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ. Except for those who repent to Allah. Except for those who do righteous deeds, good deeds, and they hold fast to Allah. They hold fast to the book of Allah. They hold fast to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Except for them, those who put their trust in Allah, those who put their iman in Allah, then they will be from amongst the believers. This is how Allah counts us. And who are the munafiq? Allah says through His Rasul, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the munafiq, إِذَا تُؤْمِنَ قَانَ. One of their signs, one of their qualities, one of their attributes is that when he is entrusted with something, he betrays. One. There are four. Imam Bukhari has listed four, alayhi rahma. When they are entrusted with something, they betray it. The second thing, وَإِذَا حَدَّثَ كَذَبَ. When he speaks, he lies. Plenty lies. Subhanallah. This does not happen to a Muslim, you know. A believer don't operate like that. This is for who? A munafiq. The third thing, وَإِذَا عَهَدَ غَدَرَ. Whenever he makes an agreement with somebody, what he does? He breaks that agreement. Sign a business contract, a business deal. You promise to pay this brother, you promise to pay this sister after a certain amount of days. And when the time passes, you come in and you say, boy, I never know about that. You break your contract with people. This is a sign of a munafiq. And the last thing, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَإِذَا خَاسَمَا فَجَرَ. Whenever he quarrels, whenever she quarrels, they behave in such a manner. Imprudent. Bold face, out of timing, as we will say. evil, wicked, and in an insulting manner. Anybody who possesses these four characteristics or qualities, they are qualities of the munafiq. If they possess one, it is still one of the qualities of the munafiq. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, investigate your lives, O believers. Investigate your lives, O believers. Which one am I falling into? When somebody gives me something as amanat, do I betray their trust? When I make a deal with somebody, do I break that? When I speak, do I lie? When I quarrel, do I become evil and debasing? Ask yourselves which one we fall into. Because anyone we fall to, they are qualities of the munafiq, hypocrites. And we as believers, we are not supposed to possess these qualities. So just yesterday, we did a slaughtering. And if we did not slaughter these things with our animals, then we had lacked somewhere. So this is why Islam has given us 3 days. 3 days to perform slaughtering. Allahu Akbar. 3 days. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow. If we didn't do it yesterday, we have a chance today to slaughter our nafs. Slaughter the lies that we tell. Slaughter the betrayal. Slaughter these things, the quarreling and the argument. Slaughter when we perform these contracts and agreements and we break them. Slaughter all these things. Bring back the love for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our lives. We look now for love sharing. We look for giving. We look for compassion. We look for caring. We look for togetherness. We look for brotherhood. We look for sisterhood. We look for all these things, sympathy, empathy, all these things that the Ummah was once blessed with. We are looking for these things to come back. Remove the hate, remove the anger, remove the malice, remove the grudge, remove the hypocrisy, remove the envy, remove the jealousy, remove all these evil qualities of shaitan. Replace them with the qualities of Allah. Allah is Rahman, compassion. Allah is Rahim. Allah is merciful. Allah is Wadud. Allah is loving. Allah is Ghani. Allah is rich. Share your wealth. Allah is Basir. Allah is seeing everything. You became a watcher for your brother. Allah is Sami. You look out for your neighbors. You look out for your friends. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 99 attributes. Each of these attributes, a portion of it Allah has placed in the life of the believer. This is why we find a different love for the wife, a different love for the children, a different love for the wealth, a different love for our neighbors, a different love for our friends. How many different types of love we have in our hearts? Huh? We find different mercy for this one, different mercy for that one, different mercy for the animals, different mercies for the birds, you name it. Allah has placed a little bit of his 99 attributes in the lives of the believers. We have to bring it back. Forget the disunity. It is time to unite upon the tawheed of Allah, upon the oneness of Allah, and all these other factors that are supposed to unite us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May He open our eyes. May He open our hearts. May He cause this message to reach into my life. Put it into practice and into your lives so that we can put it into practice. If we investigate this message and we see that there is truth in this message, we find ourselves guilty of whatever is coming out from this message, let us try to make a change. Let us try to make a change, starting with myself. Starting with myself. Because if we make an effort towards that change for the pleasure of Allah, and we die while making that effort, Allah is going to forgive us, inshallah, and take us to Jannah. Remember the man who had killed 99 people and he was looking for forgiveness from Allah? He was looking to make a change in his life and he was advised to go to such and such a place. And while he was going, he did not even reach a place yet. Malikul Maut came and took him. The hadith is in Bukhari. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his miracle, the angel responsible for taking the lives of good people came. That one responsible for taking the lives of bad people, he also came. They had a big dispute. Who is going to take him? This man just killed 100 people. This one said, no, he was looking for forgiveness. He was looking to make a turnaround in his life. Allah passed the law to measure the land that he was going towards and see how far it is. And subhanAllah, when they measured it, the hadith states that he was found closer to where he was going. And Allah took him with his rahmah towards Jannah. So who can say we can be bad today? But inshallah, we have made an effort, or we are making an effort, to change the bad qualities in our lives. Allah, alaysa Allahu bi ahkamil hakimin? Isn't Allah the best to judge? Not you and me. Isn't Allah the best of all judges? Let Allah be the judge over us. So we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put it in our hearts to make a serious turnaround in our lives as we come out from the month of Dhul-Hijjah, coming into the new Islamic year, the new Islamic month, the month of Muharram. These days are going. It is time for us to make resolutions in changing the bad behavior, the bad conduct, the bad patterns and qualities in our lives and implementing good things in our lives for the betterment of our own souls in the akhirah when we stand before Allah. Wal akhir da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.